Principles of Finance, a la shmup. The Five Principles of Finance. Why is there always a number like this, like the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, the Six Wives of Henry VIII, the Three Musketeers, the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People? Finance, more or less, has five wheels under its chassis, and that fifth wheel sort of explains why the markets and the economy so often, you know, go off the rails. Anyway, just know these five bad boys. Here we go. Principle one, the time value of money. Mantra, a dollar today is worth more than a dollar tomorrow. Why? Well, because you can, in theory, always invest that dollar and get a positive financial return from that investment. If you picked, quote, the safest bet in the world, unquote, well, by investing in American treasury bills, which are guaranteed more or less by the American government's ability to tax its hardworking people and purviews, well, then you'd get a small return on your investment. For a more practical example, think about you investing $1,000 to buy a T-bill yielding 3%. Well, bonds like this usually pay twice a year, so 6 months later, you'd get what? Well, if your total interest per year was 3% on a grand invested, then you'd get $30 a year for doing a whole lot of nothing other than let your grand sit with the gov. So twice a year, you'd get a check for $15. Buys about two lattes, but it's a positive investment return that's pretty much guaranteed. Silly example, but there were about 182.5 days that made up the 6 months that yielded to you your $15. So how much did you earn per day based on that figure? Well, about $15 divided by 182.5. Or about 8 cents a day. Well, the gist here is that the $1,000 today was worth more than the $1,000 tomorrow. That is, invested in the form of a very safe 3% T-bill, the dollar today was worth about 8 cents more than the dollar tomorrow. Well, time value is a pretty dull concept when it's 3% a year on a relatively small amount of money, but let's calculate something more fun. Okay, our idea of fun, sorry. We netted $100 million after tax after an IPO of a company we founded. We want some toys and bling. First off, we want to shrink the world. So let's buy a jet. A shiny new CJ3 costs about $12 million and another fortune to operate, to insure, to store, to gas up, to pilot, and so on. But let's ignore all that. So we plan to keep it 20 years. After 20 years, the plane will be worth not much. Figure $4 million at auction. So we'll lose $8 million over 20 years, or 400 grand a year. So yeah, that jet was expensive, but it gets way, way worse. With a 20-year time frame, we could have felt pretty good about putting our money in the stock market in equities in the form of an index fund. Over the 150 or so years that the modern stock market has been tracked, over most 20-year periods, the market's gone up about 8 or 9%, with dividends reinvested, maybe a little bit more. And yes, there were bad periods where performance was flattish, but there were also really good periods where performance was way better than that 8 or 9% figure. So let's just pick the middle of the curve for now. If all we did with our $12 million was put it in the market and get it back 20 years later in a bad stock market era, well, we'd have done way better financially than if we had bought that new jet outright, right? We lost $8 million for the pleasure, plus maintenance, gas, and risk. And the comparable cost to fly commercial would have been massively less, that we won't even bother with that now. Let's bet that the market does what it usually does on average over this 20-year period and goes up 8.2% a year. Well, had we invested in our index fund, which charged us 0.2% a year for maintaining that index, we would have had a ton more dough. How much more? Well, the magic formula. Take the dollar amount you invested and multiply it by 1 plus the rate of return and take that quantity to the power of years. Looks like this. In this case, the formula would be $12 million times 1 plus 0.08 to the 20th power. And note that the market went up 8.2% a year, but we only kept 8.0% of it because we had 0.2% a year in fees. This is a big deal when you look at mutual funds, which carry R-rated fees, and then hedge funds, which carry triple X's, but we'll get into that later. Anyway, 1.08 to the 20th power is about 5, so gulp. If you had put your $12 million into an index fund, 20 years later, it would be worth $60 million instead of the $4 million you got. And yes, that's the right math. We checked it twice. Jets are nearly the worst investment you can make, and life's short, but the super wealthy, well, they want what they want. As Marie Antoinette said, let them eat jet fuel. Well, one other note worth noting here is a cute little formula called the Rule of 72. Read it, know how to use it. It saves lives. Well, it doesn't really save lives, but it'll make yours a lot better. Our lawyers made us say this. All right, moving on. Principle two, risk and reward are related. Popcorn question. Why do you get 8% returns from the stock market in equities and you only get 3% from safe bonds? Well, a bunch of things affect rates of investment returns, but the biggest issue revolves around whether you'll get your money back or not, and or a positive multiple of your money back over time. Okay, here's a chart of bond performance. It's flat. Basically, it's a dead man's pulse. Very few bonds don't pay back what they promise, and yes, a few go bust, but compared with equities, bonds are a massively safer investment. But you pay a big price for that safety over time. That $12 million jet money invested in a bond over 20 years at 3%, while ignoring taxes, which are also generally worse for bonds than stocks, well, it gives you just about $21.6 million. Way better than owning that jet, and think about how many first-class commercial tickets that dough would have bought. You have a lot of pretzels. Anyway, with stocks, you turned your dough into $60 million in 20 years. So for that bond safety, you just paid almost $40 million in net difference over those 20 years for that safety. How's that feel? You feel safer now, or just less wealthy? Well, things could have gone the other way. Had you bought at the worst time, say late 1973, held them to the worst period in 1993 with dividends reinvested, well, you would have compounded at only about 6%, about 10% with dividends reinvested, albeit with a lot of headache. Look at how stocks declined from 73 to 83. Brutal. But also look how dividend rates went up. That is, when companies' stocks decline, they don't usually just cut their dividends. They keep paying them, and investors who need and or want the cash returned to them from their initial investments are happy to get checks four times a year because, well, equity dividends are paid quarterly, unlike bonds, which are paid twice a year. But look at the chart. Could you have stomached being down almost 50% from 73 to 79? Would you have panicked at just the wrong time and sold all of your stocks and moved into bonds at just the wrong time? Well, taking on risk is a lot about personality and liquidity, i.e., you don't need that investment to be cashed out tomorrow, and well, it's about courage too. But over time, as you take bigger risk, you would expect to be rewarded incrementally for taking on that risk. And there are times to not take a lot of risk, of course, as well. Like if you're planning on buying a home in 6 months, well, you likely don't want to be invested in the market. In a bad 6 month period, things can go down a lot. And the big fat hairy idea here, well, it's that time bails you out of risk when you're investing in stocks. If you can hold an investment a very long time, historically, it's made no sense to own bonds instead of stocks. All right, moving on. Principle 3, the market as a popularity contest versus being a weighing machine. Warren Buffett, the Michael Phelps of public investing, said, "In the short term, the market is a popularity contest. In the long term, it's a weighing machine." Well, what on earth does that mean? Well, he's referring to short-term and long-term thinking in investing, and Buffett is a famously long-term greedy investor. That is, Buffett likes to buy things and stick them in a drawer for decades, not weeks. Over time, market prices are truth. They are accurate. They are honest. But in short periods of time, the market can go crazy. Later in this course, we'll get into the internet bubble of the late 1990s, where companies would go public on very little revenue with valuations of billions of dollars. Many of them died or simply had awful investing returns to the schmuck or speculative buyers who bought them. A few did really well. A little company called Google's one of them, Amazon's another, eBay, PayPal another. But most ended up doing poorly if you held them 20 years. Conversely, toward the end of the 2008-09 mortgage crisis, a ton of companies were trading the other way, i.e. crazy cheap. And these were stable, always going to be there companies like Coca-Cola and Pepsi, which traded down to below 10 times earnings at one point. Like, the market in the short term was telling you that the odds of people drinking drinks, not just soft drinks, was kind of an iffy proposition. Well, things normalized with Coke and Pepsi, trading it right around their adjusted historical price-to-earnings ratios in the low 20s eventually. Key takeaway, be sensitive to the sentiment the market is feeding you. But when you buy stocks for the long haul, well, just buy good companies and good industries, right? Even if you overpay in the short run, good companies bail you out in the long run. All right, principle 4, cash is king. Ever hear of Hollywood accounting? Profits? Well, they don't exist when the talent in the movie participates or gets a percentage of them. Let's go through a simple example with something a bit more tangible. The company, We're Nuts About Lug Nuts, has $400 million in revenues in a given year and $300 million in expenses, leaving $100 million to be taxed. Tack on a 30% tax rate, and after $30 million in taxes, the company is left with $70 million in earnings. Well, the shady mystical figure in all of these calculations is the notional definition of expenses. Let's say the company spent $300 million on a factory to stamp out its lug nuts more efficiently. Well, accounting rules might require that all of that money be expensed in 3 years, or it might be in 30, or it might be viewed as an investment and it just stays static forever, held at book value. If the company had to expense everything in 3 years, well, then the company would be required to expense a third of that $100 million of that $300 million each year. If they had to expense the capital expenditure of the lug nut roboto stamper in 3 years, then the $100 million of profits in that year and the two subsequent years would be fully wiped out. The company would essentially pay no taxes and, well, end of story. Alternately, the company might have had to amortize that cost over 30 years, taking off $10 million a year in expenses. From an accounting perspective, then, the company would show $90 million of profits and pay $27 million in taxes. For now, don't worry about the numbers too much. The key idea is that in order to fairly evaluate the value of a company, you have to follow the cash or cash earnings and look through accounting tricks, which can change the bottom line in earnings dramatically. All right, well, the magic word in all of this is Gaap. That's G-A-A-P, and you're supposed to say it like that. It stands for Generally Accepted Accounting Principles, and it basically just holds that when you practice accounting, you always present your numbers in the most reasonably conservative manner possible. In doing so, you take away the risk of, you know, puffing out your feathers, saying that your company is in fact more profitable than it really is. For example, think about the case where your lug nut roboto stamper really does wear out in 10 years and it has to be replaced. Well, in that case, the $300 million spent to build it should in fact be taken away in some form, amortized, depreciated in a sinking fund, whatever, so that it surprises nobody when, in 10 years, you owe another $300 million to go buy or build a new one. All right, moving on. Principle 5, last one here. Stick with us. Agency problems. All right, well, what is an agent? For most people, when they hear that term, they think about a guy in a slick suit in a Hollywood office selling clients time into a studio system with a lot of let's do lunch, you know, that regular catchphrase. And that really is what financial agency is about. When a client hires an agent, a relationship structure is formed. That is, there are legal requirements around the behavior of that agent. Specifically, the agent has to look out for the best interests of his client, and he has to put his own best interests on the back burner. This structure is a really big deal in the financial world because so many poor, unsuspecting, uneducated people have been screwed over in the process by big city slickers taking their dough with no comeuppance. Myriad laws regarding disclosure and appropriateness of advice and other elements all have blood on their hands. That is, each law that you'll learn about exists because somebody was screwed over or sued and a new law was edited to cover that corner case situation where a fast-talking thief took the money of our beloved Ma and Pa kettle.